Today we're talking about the inverse trig functions, that is inverse sine, inverse cosine, inverse tangent, inverse secant, all those things like that, how to take the derivative, okay? So part of the process here of chapter 5 is to take every other sort of weird function that we can have and try to take the derivative of it. And then once we know the derivative of that, then we take the integral of it. And so sort of rounding out all of the different types of functions. We've dealt with exponential functions in this chapter, logarithmic functions. Now we're going to deal with these other weird ones, which is the inverse trig functions. So just as a reminder what the inverse trig functions are, we've got f of x is equal to sine of x. When I talk about the inverse function, sometimes you'll see that written as arc sine or sine of inverse x right there. You may recall the sine graph, and it continues on, looks like that. Nice sinusoidal graph walking down memory lane. The arc sine graph, however, did not look like that. The arc sine graph started at the origin, and it's kind of do this thing along the y-axis, because the idea is you switch the x and the y. I don't know if we actually, how much we talked about that last year, maybe a little bit. Did we mention arc sine graphs? Yeah, it's not that big of a deal, but I know we talked about this next point. The problem with the arc sine graph is that if we draw it like this and define it, you know, set like this, then it fails the vertical line test repeatedly. Okay, you can tell that it fails. So arc sine has a limited domain. It's basically just that part right there, which allows you to pass the vertical line test. So arc sine, you can only plug in values from negative pi over 2, positive pi over 2, from negative 90 to positive 90. That's why whenever you take the inverse sine of something on your calculator, you're either going to get a fourth quadrant answer or a first quadrant answer, if you remember doing that. And then normally I just say, just get the first quadrant answer and then figure out what quadrant you're in. Okay, so anyways, that's just a little reminder there. Let's get started. So let's say that y is equal to the inverse sine of x. What we want is an expression for the derivative of that. What is the derivative of inverse sine? Josue, what's your natural first guess? Derivative of inverse sine?
The inverse of cosine.
Inverse cosine, yeah, that seemed to make sense. Okay? Unfortunately, if you look at this and we do local linearization, you end up with negatives, then you get zero, then you get more negatives and stuff like that. And inverse cosine doesn't look like that at all. Inverse cosine looks, if that's regular cosine, here's inverse cosine. It starts up here, and then, well, it does the same thing. It goes like that. But it does, we only covered that part. So here you have positive values, positive, everything's positive for the graph of inverse cosine. But if you look here at the slopes of the tangent lines on inverse sine, they're all negative. Okay? And it's what's more, it's not even like negative inverse cosine if we do some more analysis. So unfortunately, inverse sine, inverse cosine are a lot uglier than their forward-thinking function friends here. All right, so this is what we're going for. That's going to be the end of the story. Keep that in mind. What I'm going to do over here are the steps necessary to show you what this final answer is, weird though it is. And the other interesting thing is we kind of going to have to know this process every single time we do these. So here we go. What we're going to do is we're going to do implicit differentiations, or actually, we're not even going to do that first. We're going to take the sine of both sides. So whatever you do to one side, you got to do to the other. So now we have sine of y, or sining as I like to call it, equals. Let's play the game here, everybody. What is the sine of the inverse sine of x? Say it, Jesus. Nope, it's not sine. Tammy? What's x? Minus 2 plus 2.
Is it just x?
It's just x. So, the derivative with respect to x of sine y is going to be the derivative with respect to x of x. So this looks promising. The derivative of sine y is cosine y, or cosy, times dy over dx, and that's equal to derivative of x, 1. So, dy over dx equals 1 over cosine y. Okay, well that's not too bad, because we found what the derivative of y is, it's 1 over cosine y. Now, you can see it definitely has a relationship to cosine, the reciprocal, but unfortunately it's the cosine of y, not the cosine of x. All right, so, what we need to do is we need to figure out what is the cosine of y. And for that, we're going to have to draw a picture. So let's think about what this means. Y equals the inverse sine of x. Do y'all remember, what is the input on the inverse trig ratios? Like, what do we normally put inside here? So like inverse sine, what do we input there? What is x? What's that?
Theta?
Nope. That's with the regular trig ratios. Remember? Regular trig ratios. So if you have sine theta equals root 3 over 2, your input is an angle, your output is a ratio. Inverse sine, your input is the ratio, root 3 over 2, the output is the angle. And that diagram looks like theta and then root 3 and 2 right there. Okay, or root 3 over 2 and 1 right there. So it all ends up being the same thing. But okay, so we have the inverse sine of x. So that means that x is the ratio of the y value over the hypotenuse. Now that's starting to look really strange, because we're labeling the vertical distance, but we're labeling it as x. But that's what's going on here. It's going to get even weirder. Where do I put the y? Right here?
No. No, in the sides of
the angle. Yeah. Why is the angle? Okay. Yeah. Now, but that's not too bad, because if you look down here, I'm trying to find cosine of y. Okay. So cosine of an angle. Well, that's great. I've got an angle. Cosine is the adjacent over the hypotenuse. So all I need to do is find this adjacent right here. And I declare that we shall do it using the Pythagorean theorem. So this is going to be, you know, this squared plus x squared equals 1 squared. So, so question mark squared plus x squared equals 1 squared. So question mark squared equals 1 minus x squared. And so question mark equals square root 1 minus x squared. Is that what you're saying? Yep. So, cosine is 1 over adjacent square root of 1 minus x squared over hypotenuse. Square root 1 minus x squared over hypotenuse, which is 1. So that just cancels.
Could we just make that 1 minus x?
No. Because it is not a property of square roots that you could take that and just write it as this. Not allowed. If it was the square root of a squared times b squared, then you could split it up based on the property of, and then you could write a and b. That's allowed. Have fun times. This one,
okay,
is not allowed. You cannot just take the square root of a difference. And if you don't believe me, just throw in some numbers here, okay, and see if it works. Take 5 squared minus 3 squared. Let's take the square root and see if this is exact. Okay. Because 5 squared minus 3 squared is 25 minus 9, which is 16. The square root is 4. 5 minus 3 is 2. So you can do that. All right. Now, if you're asking if we can get rid of that 1, the answer is absolutely yes. And if you notice, we now have our answer. The derivative with respect to x is 1 over the square root of 1 minus x squared. And that's this answer right here. I'll summarize right here. Derivative with respect to x of the inverse sine of x is 1 over the square root of 1 minus x squared. That completes 1/6 of our lesson for today. We shall now do the other 6 functions. Okay? Like I said, a little bit uglier, not as pretty, but something you've got to have memorized. Next up, cosine. So y equals inverse cosine. See if we can go even faster. Yes, we can. Step 1, take the cosine of both sides. Cosine of y equals cosine times the inverse cosine of x. Cammie, what's the cosine of the inverse cosine of x? X. Now let's take the derivative. I'm not going to write, so the derivative of cosine, everyone, is?
Negative sine.
Negative sine. So the derivative of cosine of y is negative sine y times dy over dx equals derivative of x?
1.
So, therefore, dy over dx is 1 over negative sine y. Let's draw that picture and figure out what sine y looks like. So, we have y equals inverse cosine of x. So, that means y is the angle. And x is the ratio of the adjacent over the hypotenuse. So, anybody want to maybe guess what this other leg here is? Using Pythagorean theorem? What do you think, Crystal? Shall we derive it? Question squared plus x squared equals 1 squared. So question squared equals 1 minus x squared. So question equals the square root of 1 minus x squared. Well, that's not too bad. In fact, it's exactly what it was on the other one. So, 1 over negative square root 1 minus x squared.
Is it negative square root because of the negative sign?
That negative is written here.
Okay.
I wrote it right up here on this one.
Okay.
Now you remember you can put that negative in the numerator denominator out front. Mm-hmm. You just can't put it in one spot. I kind of wrote it a little up and kind of up front, just kind of leave it there. But probably the better place to write it would be out front. All right, Jesus, you stickler for technicalities, Mr. Detail. I respect that. Okay, well that's not too bad because we were able. If we know sine, then we just have to remember that cosine is the negative of that weird thing. All right, you'll never guess where we're going now. Let's do it. Y'all call out to me, following the same procedure each time. Take tangent on both sides, I'm hearing, okay. So, tan equals x. Take the derivative of both sides, so... Who knows? Katie, you remember derivative of tangent?
No.
There we go, mission, good job. Secant squared. Oh, remember your implicit differentiation? Dy over dx. Derivative of x is 1. So therefore, dy over dx equals 1 over secant squared y, or sec.
What?
Oh, sorry, secant. Well, I mean, we had tanny, we had cozy, siny, this is
secy.
Alright, I'm not really liking the 1 over secant squared. Y'all remember your reciprocal identities? 1 over secant is... cosine squared, whatever goes in. Okay. Well, that was nice because didn't we figure out what cosine? Well, let's go ahead and draw the picture.
Well, it's squared. Would it just be that square?
No, because this is not, cosine squared is not cosine, inverse cosine. And that's the derivative, so. And the picture is going to be different because it's the tangent. So, I'll take care of the easy part. Why is the angle? What am I going to put where? So this is, remember, this is going to be our ratio. X over 1. It is sine over cosine. It's also opposite over adjacent.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So it's your toa.
So X would be the red arrow.
Yep.
And then 1 would be the one under.
There we go. And what's the hypotenuse going to be?
Question mark.
Okay, question mark. So let's do the Pythagorean theorem here. So X squared plus 1 squared equals question mark squared. So question mark is the square root of
x plus 1
x squared plus 1. So square root x squared plus 1. So the cosine of y squared, I'll put, but here's y. The cosine of y is going to be 1 over the square root of x squared plus 1. And then we square that. So 1 squared is 1. And the square root of x squared plus 1 squared is
x squared plus 1.
X squared plus 1. And we're halfway there. Now traditionally, we don't write x squared plus 1. We write 1 plus x squared. No, but it does make it a little bit easier to see the format there. Because you're always seeing squares. Okay. As a table, I want you to take care of cotangent. You might think that there's a pattern, but I want you to prove it or disprove it. So do y'all have 1 over negative cosecant squared y?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And so when we draw the picture, y is right here. Where am I going to put the x? Adjacent or opposite?
I think that's where it is.
Hey, that's nice, because x and a 1, that means it's the same thing. X. This is the square root of x squared plus 1.
Yeah.
Now, 1 over cosecant squared is... Okay, so negative sine squared y. So that's negative sine is opposite over
frontage, so 1 over the square root of x squared plus 1 quantity squared, so that's just negative 1 over 1 plus x squared.
Okay, so our hypothesis that it was just the negative, was that, turned out to be true? Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was.
So, derivative respect to x of inverse cotangent of x is negative 1 over 1 plus x squared.
And now for the last one, and the nice thing is we'll do this for secant, and I can tell you, and if you don't believe it, you can do it for yourself, that the derivative of cosecant, or of inverse cosecant, is just going to be, it's negative. So last one, here we go. Y equals the inverse secant of x. So we'll go and take the secant of both sides. So secant of y equals x. Tell me out of class, what's the derivative of secant?
Yeah, secant y, tangent y. This is great because it's a good review on our trig derivatives. So times dy over dx equals 1. This one's going to get a little bit messy here. So we'll divide both sides by secant y, tangent y. So we have dy over dx equals 1 over secant y, tangent y. Don't over the picture.
Could we just convert that into sines and cosines?
We could.
That's sort of a little bit of trick proof stuff here. So secant is
1 over cosine.
1 over cosine. So I can
cosine.
Cosine up here in the numerator? Mm-hmm. Or well, but okay, so you've got 1 over cosine. Tangent is
sine over cosine.
Sine over cosine.
So it'll be cosine squared x over sine?
Yeah. Well, it's 1 over all of that.
Yeah. So
right. Okay, so yeah, so then you're gonna flip it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, sure. So we've got cosine squared x over sine x. Now hold on, these are all y's. y. Because my x's and y's are looking at like each other. Okay. So there's y.
Y is the inverse of secant. So,
what is that in terms of x? So, secant is hypotenuse over adjacent.
Mm-hmm.
So r over adjacent. So, it looks like x is on the hypotenuse, and 1 is there on the adjacent. So this one's going to be the square root of x squared minus 1.
So cosine squared is 1 over x squared, and sine it's going to be, so square root x squared minus 1 over x. Okay, I do like this going. So fractions of fractions, that's 1 over x squared times the reciprocal of the denominator, divided by the square root of x squared minus 1. X is canceled out. We have 1 over x times the square root of x minus 1. note that there is a limitation on our diagram here that always that hypotenuse x has to be positive. Okay? Could have different angles, stuff like that, but that's a limitation here. So as a result, the way that I'm going to make sure that this x right here is always positive is I'm going to put absolute value bars around that. This x squared is guaranteed to always be positive. So the derivative with respect to x of inverse secant of x is 1 over the absolute value of x times the square root of x squared minus 1. And the derivative with respect to x of inverse cosecant is negative 1 over the absolute value of x times the square root of x squared minus 1. Alright, congratulations. You have just derived the derivative to the 6 inverse trig functions. So that's just more weapons in your arsenal here. All right, let's see here. Let's go ahead and do a couple of these of your homework problems together. Why not? So, instructions are pretty straightforward. Take the derivative of that function and I differentiate with respect to x. So, dy over dx equals, oh, by the way, I forgot to tell you, since you know the derivative with respect to x, you can also now know the derivative with respect to x of inverse sine of u, right? It's just going to be 1 over the square root of 1 minus u squared times, chain rule, u prime. Okay? So it's exactly same as all these, you get a function of x inside there. Chain rule is a great thing. So here we have inverse sine, so that's going to be 1 over square root of 1 minus negative 3x to the 5th quantity squared times derivative of the inside, which is and we'll go ahead and clean this up just a little bit if we can. We'll bring that negative 15 to the fourth over there to the numerator. Square root 1 minus and negative 3x to the fifth squared is going to be 9x to the 10th.
Should we not do anything with that other squared?
The square?
Yes.
I just did. I simplified negative 3x to the 5th over 9x to the
10th. Oh, so we don't take use it for a derivative or anything?
No, because the formula is that it's going to be 1 over 1 minus the square root of x squared. Okay? So this is playing the part of our u. So that's playing the part of the u. Okay. So I'm taking the derivative of this, not of this. Does that make sense? Okay. I understand your question now. Yeah, because you might be like, well, if we take the derivative of this, we can bring the 2 down, and da 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 da, no, something like that. No, we're taking the derivative of that thing right there. That's a great answer. Box it. Put a fork in it. It's done. Let's try number 6, shall we? Alright, so there's y equals inverse secant of 5x to the fifth. So that's our u. So dy over dx is equal to, help me out here, folks, for secant.
The absolute value of x.
Okay, and so in this case, it would be the absolute value of u, so 5x to the fifth. Keep going.
Square root of u squared minus 1.
Okay, so I'll write 5x to the fifth squared minus 1. And then times u prime. So we have 25x to the 4th over absolute value of 5x to the 5th square root 25x to the 10th minus 1. Now, can we simplify this at all? Possibly. I mean, we might be able to pull that 5 out because the absolute value of 5 is just going to be 5. So we might be able to reduce that to a 5. Absolute value of x square root of 5x to the 10th minus 1. I think so. I mean, because 4 of those are going to cancel out. Yeah, and then we're just going to make sure we have the absolute value of x right there. That makes sense to me. That way it's always positive. I can't just strip the absolute value because then if x is negative, then... Okay, yep, I like that. You are smarter than my workbook, or my worksheet analysis tool, because this is what it says. You can't see it right here, but it's going to leave it in unsimplified form. But this is a great answer right here.
So do you want to say something about it?
Yeah, if you can, do it. And then when we look at it, we'll laugh at it and say, ha ha ha, you can simplify. Should have simplified. Simplify. Cancel out those extra fours. We don't need them. Okay, so I guess this wasn't very bad of a class. You just learned 6 new formulas, 6 new derivative rules, and we've started to apply them. Go ahead and take care of that homework. If you can, bring that back finished tomorrow. We'll just grade it in the first couple minutes. Don't we have a quiz tomorrow? Unfortunately, no. I'm going to push that quiz to Friday because we had to push this lesson that I'm sharing with you today. I had scheduled for Monday, but we needed more preparation for that quiz and grading that stuff. So, yeah, everything's getting pushed down. Except for the quiz corrections. Those are still due on Friday. What I'm saying is the solo quiz will be on Friday. And I'll tell you what. If you want to do corrections, I will let you do that in preparation because y'all, it'd probably be good for you to look at what you did wrong on that quiz if you want to be prepared for the solo quiz. So today and tomorrow, you can come in after school, during lunch, if you have a free period, and I'll let you do those corrections. Okay? All right. Thanks. Try to get the button there if you don't mind.